Well, it's nice to be here. I just want to say that after I moved from Russia to the United States, my first conference I attended was conference in Trieste. And it was 1991, organized by Jacob Pallas and Yaakov Sinai. And it became kind of a tradition for several years. So I'm actually very happy to see that this tradition has developed into substantially more interesting and broad, like those schools and conference, and it's thanks to the organizers again, Stefano, first of all. So it's nice to see that it's not only alive, but it's also doing pretty well. So the topic of my talk is thermodynamics of the Katok map. And I would like to say that before I proceed that last year I gave a talk here at the same room about building thermodynamics for non-uniformly hyperbolic systems. And the reason I kind of advocating thermodynamics is that in, from my point of view, there are a number of very interesting, still very open problems in non-hyperbolic dynamics. Just to mention, one of them is the genericity of systems with non-zero Lyapunov exponent in class of smoothness C2, not C1. For C1, it's pretty much known, but it's a completely different world. There are other very interesting problems, still very much open in non-hyperbolic dynamics, non-uniformly hyperbolic dynamics. For another one is a coexistence of dynamical system with non-zero exponents and essential coexistence and systems with zero entropy. So the space is split into two, and I will mention this during my talk a little bit. So the space is split into two. On one part, the system is non-uniformly hyperbolic, and this part is open and dense. The other part has positive measure, but has zero entropy. So that's another great problem. And the third problem, I mean, the list, of course, goes on, but the third one is thermodynamics for non-uniformly hyperbolic maps. And fortunately, during the last few years, there's been substantial progress in understanding how to build thermodynamics for non-uniformly hyperbolic maps. And today I will explain one example where it was done, but there is a theory behind this example, which I briefly mentioned. And there are other methods now available that, for example, von Kleinman-Hage talked during his talk on non-uniform specifications and things like that. So there is, at the moment, there is a collection of techniques which was developed that one can use to affect thermodynamical formalism. And today, we'll talk about one examples of this type. So the map that I'm going to talk about is the Katok map. It was introduced by Katok in his very famous paper in Annals in 1981. I believe that most of you might have heard about this map, but I will briefly go over it just to explain what this map is about. And this was the first example of a diffeomorphism with non-zero Lyapunov exponent. It starts with a two-dimensional map on the two-dimensional torus, which is just a hyperbolic automorphism. The cat map, as you recall, called it, given by this matrix. And the idea is that this linear hyperbolic automorphism has a point zero as a fixed point, of course. So what I would like to do, I would like to perturb this map in a small neighborhood of zero, leaving the rest unchanged. The perturbation that I'm going to make is localized, and the neighborhood will be very small. But the perturbation itself will not be small, because if it's small, then you end up with an annosive diffeomorphism. And I want to construct a diffeomorphism on the torus which is not uniformly hyperbolic. So to do that, I choose a function psi, which is a C infinity except at the origins. You should think about the graph of this function as being the following. This is the graph of the function psi. So it's 1 when you exceed some number R naught, and then it's C infinity except for this point. And the reason I want it to be like that is that the last requirement, that the inverse of the function is integrable. So I use this function to slow down trajectories of the original map in a small neighborhood of size R naught around zero. So my next step is to consider the disk, choose R naught such that we have this property, and T is a linear map which is given by the matrix A, so I distinguish between the matrix and the map. And then the main trick is that in the small neighborhood of the origin, the trajectory moves along hyperboles. That's a linear map. That's what the standard automorphism does. And then you can embed these trajectories into a flow, and that's a local flow given by this system of differential equations. That's easy. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to perturb the flow. And a perturbation of the flow is by multiplying by this function psi, which will depend only on the squares of S1 and S2. So it's a function of one variable, and which graph is here, and which satisfies the conditions I wrote before. And so if you look at the trajectories of this flow, so it's, again, a local flow, which is only defined in a small neighborhood of the origin. So what happened is that you have many more points along the trajectory. If you take time one map of the flows, then you would have many more points on the hyperbole than it was before. And the closer the trajectory starts to zero, the more points you see. In particular, if you start on the stable separatrix, that the trajectory will slow converge to zero with a rate which is not exponential. So that's basic idea. So for that, I can say that I will consider the time one map of the flow denoted by G, and then I consider the map capital G, which is my hyperbolic toral automorphism outside the small neighborhood, and inside is a time one map of this flow. And this will produce a map on the torus, which is C infinity everywhere except at the origin, because my function psi is not C infinity at the origin. So I lost differentiability at C infinity at this point, at this moment. I will recover it later, but at this moment, the map is almost C infinity, but it's not exactly. So what I want to say is that because of this requirement, it turns out that the map which I just constructed preserves a measure which is absolutely continuous with respect to area. And it's given by the density. This is explicit formula for the density. It's a simple calculation. Kappa naught is a normalizing factor. And this density is blowing up at zero. So it goes to infinity at zero. But it's integrable. It's integrable because of this fact. So it's finite measure, absolutely continuous with respect to area, but it has singularity at zero. So in order to correct this construction and produce a really C infinity map of the torus, I need one more perturbation. And that one more perturbation is the following. If you, since if you look at the, what happened in the origin, then the area, the new absolutely continuous invariant measure blows up at zero, meaning that it gives a lot of mass close to zero. So what the idea is to push this mass away from zero. And this so instead of going along the hyperbole, I just push it in a symmetric way, in a nice symmetric way, outside of zero. This is an explicit formula that produces this coordinate change. This can be viewed as just a coordinate change. And then after doing that, we obtain a map, which is conjugation of my map G by this coordinate change. And the resulting map will be a C infinity diffeomorphism, area preserving, because this map phi will move this absolutely continuous invariant measure into real area. And this is just a matter of computation. This is explicit formula. It's not difficult to compute that the resulting measure is the area. So the map we obtained is called the Katok map. That's the definition of the map. And then the question is, you have an area preserving C infinity diffeomorphism of the torus. What properties does it have? So that's basically the question. Well, here are the properties. First of all, the map F is topologically conjugate to unperturbed linear automorphism. So there is a homeomorphism H, which conjugates the Katok map and the linear map. But the conjugacy is continuous, but not Hölder continuous. And that's crucial for us. Because in the study of thermodynamics, you normally like to deal with the Hölder continuous functions. If you take a Hölder continuous function on the torus and push it back by the homeomorphism, if it were Hölder continuous, you obtain a Hölder continuous function. You can use this Hölder continuous function and the linear map A, develop the whole business of thermodynamics. It's easy, it's a hyperbolic map, everybody knows that. Push it back by homeomorphism and get an equilibrium measure, whatever you want. Unfortunately, it just doesn't work this way for the simple reason that the conjugacy is not Hölder continuous. You start from a Hölder continuous function, you push it back, you get non-Hölder continuous function for the map A. It's known that if you have non-Hölder continuous function for a uniformly hyperbolic map, even linear hyperbolic map, then in general, you may not have unique equilibrium measure. So things can go wrong if the function is not Hölder continuous. And therefore, it's a question what to do. I mean, it's a nice fact, but the question how to use it. It cannot be used directly. The second property is that the Katok map lies on the boundary of an osmotic diffeomorphism of the torus. So here I would like to say that if this is a space of all C2 or C infinity diffeomorphism on the torus, then you pick the matrix A. There is a small neighborhood of this matrix which consists of an osmotic diffeomorphisms, right? Because any small perturbation of A is still an osmotic diffeomorphism. So what you do, you just consider the biggest possible connected component of A, which consists of an osmotic diffeomorphism. And you end up with, I don't know, some open set. That's an open set, of course. So what one can do, what this statement 2 says, that you can start from here and draw a curve in this space, which goes through an osmotic diffeomorphism. And in the end, when it reaches the boundary, so this is A, and this is the Katok map F. It's a simple exercise, and I leave it for you because this is not just a conference, it's a school, so you're students, so I can give you some problems or exercises. So this is a simple exercise to construct such a curve, starting from A and end up with F. You just work with the function psi, and you can see how you should vary the function psi to obtain such a curve. But this can't be done. In fact, what happened that if you, here you have all an osmotic, at this particular curve you end up with Katok and you know that it's non-uniformly hyperbolic. A good question is that true that any diffeomorphism on the boundary of an osmotic has non-zero Lyapunov exponents? It's not an osmotic because it lies on the boundary. Otherwise, if it would be an osmotic, you can extend it, you can build another ball around it. So once it's on the boundary, then it's not an osmotic. The question is, does it have non-zero Lyapunov exponent, or whether it has all non-zero Lyapunov, I mean, almost everywhere. And I'm talking about diffeomorphisms that preserve area. So it's not just funny diffeomorphism, but area preserving. So that's an interesting question. I don't have an answer to that. Now, another question is, can you extend this curve beyond an osmotic, beyond the boundary? Well, for example, you can make a perturbation that does not leave the point zero fixed. It can move it somewhere and do something. The point zero for the Katok map is a neutral fixed point. The derivative at this point, the differential is identity. So you can always blow it up to produce an elliptic island. And if you produce an elliptic island, that's a coexistence of behavior which is that I mentioned before. So you would have ergodic components with non-zero Lyapunov exponent outside and an elliptic island inside. Now, this is a picture that I have in mind, but I don't have a theorem. So everyone is welcome to prove that. Whether this curve can be extended, and I don't tell you in which direction should it go. It may go this direction, who knows which direction. But one can produce a direction along which you obtain exactly one island, elliptic island, and the rest will be an ergodic component with non-zero Lyapunov exponent. That's a great problem about the Katok map, which is open. Now, there are results by Pshetitsky and Liverani who obtain such curves, starting from some other Anosov map, producing a curve that actually goes through, and here on a small part of this, you can see one elliptic island. So you can go to papers of Pshetitsky and Liverani and find this result. This is a different curve. I believe the result is the same, but I don't know. Then the map is ergodic. In fact, it's isomorphic to Bernoulli. It's topologically transitive, it's mixing, it has very nice ergodic properties. And this is, again, a nice exercise for you guys to prove that it is ergodic. It doesn't involve any sophisticated argument. It's you just say, let me have an invariant set of positive area. I want to show that it has full measure. Yes. I'm sorry, can you say it louder? Not necessarily. Not necessarily. I'm just saying whichever way you can do it. If you can do it this way, fine. I don't think so. I don't think you can do that, but whichever way. And the property that I'm most interested in is that this map has non-zero Lyapunov exponent in almost everywhere in the neighborhood. One thing I want to say is that, of course, if you look at this at the Katok map, so this is a torus, this is a fixed point, this is a neighborhood where we do the perturbation, and the trajectory is like that. This point is neutral. The differential is one. It has zero exponents. So you have at least one point with zero exponent. In fact, if you take any points that start on the stable separatrix, you get zero exponents because the slowdown is such that it comes very slowly to zero. It approaches zero with a very small speed, and therefore it's zero. And then you push the stable separatrix away, and you get a dense set which consists of points with zero exponents. So you have plenty points with zero exponent. However, one can prove that this set has zero measure. So there's no, there are other points, except for the separatrices, there are other points with zero exponent. So this does not exhaust the whole set with zero exponent, but whatever this set is, it has zero exponent, it has zero area. So it's a system with non-zero exponents. Well, other properties is that since it's a system with non-zero Lyapunov exponent, almost everywhere you can construct stable and unstable distributions. But the non-uniform hyperbolicity gives them at almost every point. What this statement says is that we can extend it to the whole area, including zero, by the way, to obtain a continuous distributions. And that's a non-trivial statement at all. And then those distributions can be integrated. Well, there are one-dimensional distributions that can always be integrated. The question is whether you can uniquely integrate, and that's the claim. So, you can do that. And those foliations that you obtain are images under the conjugacy of the standard stable unstable foliation for the linear map. So, the picture is pretty nice in this sense. Now, the reason for Katok to introduce this map was not just to build this example, he wanted to build C infinity diffeomorphism with non-zero exponent on any surface. And for for him, this map that we now call Katok map was a starting point. So the next step, you start from the torus, but next step is to build such a map on the sphere. And to do this on the sphere, you change the original map, you just take the fourth power of that. There is reason for number four. The matrix you obtain will be this one, and the reason for four is that now this matrix has four fixed points. If you have four fixed points, what you do, you perform the slowdown procedure around each of them in the way I just described. Outside of the small neighborhood of these four points, it's a linear map. Inside, it's those slowdown procedures. This way, you get a map. It has non-zero Lyapunov exponents, et cetera, still on the torus. But now you use a standard topological procedure, which says that you consider the involution map, which is given by this formula on the torus. Remember, the torus is just a square, so it has global coordinate system. Then this involution has these points as a fixed point. It commutes with the Katok map, and the factor space is a sphere, which allows you now to bring the Katok map to the sphere. So now you have a map with non-zero Lyapunov exponent on the sphere. Well, you go to the next step, which is punch the sphere in one of this fixed point, unfold it to a disk, and now you have a diffeomorphism with non-zero Lyapunov exponent on a disk. It has an advantage that on the boundary of the disk, because you punch it at a fixed point, the map is identity. So let's remember that. Now you take any surface. You know very well that you can cut the surface so that you get a polygon. Topologically, polygon and the disk are the same thing, so you can move one into another. That's a well-known topological procedure. What was not known before the Katok work is that using this procedure, you can carry over the diffeomorphism on the disk to a diffeomorphism, not a homeomorphism, but a diffeomorphism on the surface. And to be able to do that, you need that the map on the boundary is identity. So on those cuts, the map will be identity. But you also need the property that when you come close to the boundary of the disk, the derivatives come very fast, become close to identity. To zeros. This can be ensured if you choose a function psi here, very, very flat. So it goes like that. It has to be extremely flat. If the function psi is extremely flat, then the map on the disk will have derivative approaching the boundary of the disk very quickly, and it will be very flat in the neighborhood of the boundary of the disk. And a diffeomorphism with these properties can be carried over to any surface. And this way, you get a diffeomorphism on any surface with non-zero Lyapunov exponent. Well, that was a first step in trying to build non-zero Lyapunov maps with non-zero Lyapunov exponent on any manifold. So Katok did it for surfaces. Then there were a number of intermediate results. I mean, the problem that actually was a motivated problem for Katok was not just to build a system with non-zero Lyapunov exponent, but the matter is you use now non-uniform hyperbolicity theorem to claim that this map is Bernoulli. So immediate corollary, on any surface there is a Bernoulli diffeomorphism. That was an important problem in ergodic theory, classical ergodic theory. So the question is, can you extend it from two dimensions to any dimensions? And there was a paper by Breen, Katok, and Feldman where they showed that you can do it. On any manifold, you can build a diffeomorphism which is Bernoulli. But that diffeomorphism that they constructed had one zero exponent. So the question then, can you change the construction so that you have non-zero exponent and Bernoulli? And that was done in my paper with Dima Dolgopyat. So now it's completely settled. Any manifold of dimension bigger or equal than 2 has a C-infinity area volume-preserving diffeomorphism with non-zero Lyapunov exponent, which is Bernoulli. So from that point of view, this problem is solved. The question is, how many we have? what's happened when we perturb them. And then we go back to those problems that I just posed. But let me, so that was one direction to go when you study Katok map. The next direction to go is to build thermodynamic. Well, I just wrote that. There have been a number of talks where, you know, where people talk about thermodynamic equilibrium measures, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm not going to repeat that. Just tell you that this is a notion of the equilibrium measure. And what I'm actually interested in, is geometric, what I call a geometric T potential. So when you have a system with, when you have a hyperbolic system, you can consider unstable direction. You take Jacobian along this direction, log of this, multiply by a parameter T, you get a family of potentials. And the question is, not just any potential, but that potential, does it have a unique equilibrium measure? And if it does, what ergodic properties this measure has? And that's what I call thermodynamic for this particular talk. Now, if the map is uniformly hyperbolic, for example, if it has uniformly hyperbolic attractor or a hyperbolic, the axiom A map or whatever, then these subspaces are Hölder continuous. Therefore, this function is Hölder continuous. And there is a well-known result that any Hölder continuous function for hyperbolic map has unique equilibrium measure, and this measure is fantastic, Bernoulli, it has all the fantastic ergodic properties, exponential decay of correlation, central limit theorem, you name the property, and it has it. Okay, so that's the best case scenario. Now you go away from that. Oh, before we go away, I also would like to consider this function. It's called the pressure function. For that particular potential, you have this pressure function. It's easier to draw the graph of this function, which is just like that. It's real analytic, strictly convex, etc., etc. This value at zero is a topological entropy of the map, and the corresponding measure is a measure of maximal entropy, and this number is less or equal than one. In the case of hyperbolic attractor, it's one, and the corresponding equilibrium measure is a famous Sinai-Reil-Bowen measure. In the case when it's less than one, you still have a nice equilibrium measure, and it has certain meanings, certain relations to dimension theory, et cetera, et cetera. So all those measures are kind of interesting. That's why the geometric potential is so good. Okay. However, I would like to stress that once we move to non-uniformly hyperbolic case, this dependence is no longer Hölder. So you lose the property of this potential to be Hölder. Now, if we use a result by Omri Sarek that Yuri talked about and consider a countable marker, let's say we are on a surface and you consider a Markov partition, albeit countable, you can lift this potential to this Markov partition. And what is important is that it is Hölder continuous in the metric of this countable metric, subshift. And if this is the case, then you are in a good shape, reasonably good shape. You can still get a lot of information about equilibrium measure. So it does not, so what I'm trying to say is that this potential does not have to be Hölder continuous, but its lift to symbolic space should be Hölder continuous. And that one can prove in many cases. And that's actually works. This idea actually can be implemented in some cases. But in the cases that I'm going to consider, it unfortunately doesn't work this way. So we have to do something else. Anyway, so if you move from uniformly hyperbolic case, there are plenty of results on existence and uniqueness, etc. I just list some of them in the one-dimensional maps. The thermodynamics was built for, in the case of unimodal, multimodal maps, and this is a list of people who worked on this. The lists are not, I mean, many names are missing, so don't blame me if you know some work which is not mentioned here. I just cannot list everyone. Then there is another good class of one-dimensional maps within different fixed point, another collection of people who proved existence and uniqueness and studied ergodic properties of equilibrium meshes. Then there is a polynomial and rational maps, which somehow can be viewed as like one-dimensional maps. It's kind of the same story. And the general picture in all these examples is that this function is real, analytic, everything is fine, but it's only defined on a certain interval from T naught to T1. One can prove that on this interval, everything is fine, equilibrium measure exists and unique. But there might be two points where a phase transition occurs. Uniqueness is lost. Very often, this point T1 is just one. Not necessarily. And T0, it's an interesting question where T0 should appear. I will comment on that if I have time a little later. And then there is a work on, there is a work on non-uniform hyperbolic expanding maps or maps with dominated splitting where one direction, either stable or unstable, is non-uniformly hyperbolic. And again, there is a list of people that I have here. The list is, again, not complete. And there are different results in this direction. Some claim existence and uniqueness. Some claim just uniqueness provided it exists, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm not going to, I mean, this is not a talk about surveying all of those results. Just mention that there have been a lot of activities. However, if you go to, in all of them, you either have low dimensional, like one dimensions, or you have some uniform hyperbolicity, maybe weaker than the standard one, still built in. The Katok map is a case where no uniform hyperbolicity whatsoever is present. So it does not fit in any of these categories. And the question is how to study this. Okay. So for the for my purpose, my function psi will be in a particular form. So this function is not too flat. It's a polynomial function in this sense. So I cannot use it to build a diffeomorphism on any manifold. But I'm fine because I'm only interested in what's happening on the torus. And for the torus, that works fine. Now, my alpha is less than 1, which means that the corresponding Katok map is area preserving. It's an interesting question whether the results I'm going to explain will work when alpha is bigger than 1. Then it does not have, it has an infinite absolutely continuous invariant measure. However, you can still ask whether the geometric potential still has unique equilibrium measures. That would be an extremely interesting question. I don't have an answer to that. If you ask me, I would say bet that it's true, but I don't know. I may lose. So, it very well could happen. So here's a theorem. There is a theorem describing thermodynamics for the Katok map. So the theorem says that for arbitrary large number T naught. So I can choose this T naught as far to minus infinity as I want. But it's still finite. I cannot push it to minus infinity. There exists R naught, which is the size of slowdown domain, such that for every T naught between, for every T in this interval, so the one critical point is 1, the other one is very far to minus infinity. What happened is that there exists unique equilibrium ergodic measure mu t associated with the geometric potential. So the equilibrium measure exists and unique. Now, because my maps is C infinity, you should understand that by result of Newhouse, it always has, for any continuous function, it always has an equilibrium measure. Since if I go backward, since those subspaces are continuous, they are not Hölder continuous, but they are continuous, this function is continuous, which means that there is always an equilibrium measure. So in fact, the whole statement is not about existence, but about uniqueness. That's what makes it hard. Existence is essentially for free because it's the infinity. Then what we go next is this measure has nice properties. It has exponential decay of correlation, satisfies central limit theorem for the class of nice test functions. The pressure function is real analytic on that interval. At the point one, so here is one, and at this point you have phase transition. You have two equilibrium measures. One is area, another one is the Dirac measure at zero, which is clearly an equilibrium measure in this case. And for t bigger than one, that Dirac measure is the unique equilibrium measure for the map. So the pressure function is not differentiable here, it just continues this way. So that's the graph. The pressure function goes to minus infinity, I mean, it's like that, but there is some point, so I can prove existence and uniqueness on that interval, and it can be arbitrarily large. What I don't know what happened after this point. I know they exist, I don't know if they, I mean, what does this point do? Either it's not uniqueness, which is broken, or you still have unique equilibrium measure, but you lose the property that it has exponential decay of correlations. Maybe it does not. Or, in fact, you can choose T naught to be minus infinity. It's just the method I use it does not allow me to push it to minus infinity. Maybe you can. That are the questions I don't know how to answer, but would be very happy to know. So that's the situation for the Katok map. Let me mention that there are other good examples which are similar to the one I just, to the Katok map. And the result for this maps are similar. And the techniques that is used is similar, but not the same. And certain things are different and may not be easy to establish. So the first example, it doesn't work. Here. So the first example is that you start not from linear anosov diffeomorphism, but you start with a diffeomorphism which has a uniformly hyperbolic attractor. An example of such attractor is Smale-Williams solenoid. I guess everybody in this room should know what the Smale-Williams solenoid is. It's a classical example of an attractor, but you can pick any attractor. It is required that in the unstable direction, dimension of the unstable direction is one, but the stable direction can have any dimension. So this is actually a multi-dimensional case version of the Katok map. Now, which measure does it preserve? There's no area involved because it's an attractor, right, or volume or whatever. So there is a result by von Klimen, Hager, Dima, Dolgopyat, and myself, which claims that for that map, you do slow down in a small neighborhood exactly in the way I described. You obtain a non-uniformly hyperbolic map attractor, and the result by von Dima and myself claims that you have an SRB measure. So this is a substitute for the area. So now we are in the game, back in the game. You have a non-uniformly hyperbolic map with an SRB measure. You wonder, can you build a thermodynamics? And you can obtain the very same result which I showed on the previous slide. And this is a wonderful paper by Agnieszka Zelerowicz, who is present in this room. And it's actually a technically very hard paper, very hard to prove result. Just think a little bit. The matter is that this attractor in the stable direction is a fractal set. So it's not as nice as Katok, where kind of everything is on the, you know, essentially on the plane, et cetera, et cetera. This is a hard object to deal with. So you have to reproduce I mean, you follow the general scheme, but the road is much more difficult and much more bumpy than in the case of the Katok map. And the second example deals with Hannon map. So we consider the classical Hannon map. Now, what's known that if the parameter B is very, very small, then there exists a uniquely defined parameter A star such that the non-wandering set has a uniformly hyperbolic horseshoe for A bigger than A star. But at the moment of A star, you have a tangency. It's the first moment where hyperbolic horseshoe becomes non-uniformly hyperbolic. So you get tangency of stable and unstable. So that's called the first bifurcation parameter. And at this point, so the question is, you look at the Hannon map at this bifurcation parameter. You can prove existence of an SRB measure. And the question is, what about the thermodynamics? Well, the answer is that you can follow the scheme. You can prove the very same result I claimed before. It's the same picture for the pressure function. And you can use similar methods that I will explain in a few minutes. And it's a result by Takahashi and Sainty. The problem, the real problem here is, if you go from that parameter, which is very exceptional parameter, it's only one. It can be identified, but it's only one. So the question is, can we go to this positive measure set of parameters of Benedict Young, for which, by their result, you have an SRB measure. But that's a positive set in the space of parameters. And do thermodynamics for those parameters. That's a huge, interesting, unsolved problem. If I have time, I can tell you what distinguishes that particular parameter from all others. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is to say a few. I mean, how much time I have?
Quarter of an hour.
Okay, thank you. I just want to say a few words about the proof. So how do I want to prove that? So remember that I have a torus. My origin, this is a linear map A. And then I have another torus, where I have the Katok map F, and again the origin. And I have a conjugacy H from one to another. And this is a wonderful Anosov map. So it has a Markov partition, finite Markov partition. So this is a slow down area where everything happens. Nothing happens outside. So I choose a Markov partition whose elements are very small. And I choose one of them which is far away from the slowdown domain. Far away means something. It doesn't matter. It's not so important. Then what I'm going to do, so I call these elements P tilde. And what I'm going to do is, this is a rectangle. It's a Markov element of the Markov partition. This is clearly just a rectangle. It's a product of stable lines and unstable lines. You can think that the coordinate system is built by eigendirection, so it's just vertical and horizontal lines, nothing more than that. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to consider the first return time to this domain. So for me now, this domain is just inducing domain. I've only induced on that domain. And if I do that, I'm looking at, so let me draw it a little bigger. I'm looking at the level set of the return function. So the set of points which return back at the same time. And what I claim that if you have such a point, then the whole stable leaf, which is just a vertical line, so say this is a stable leaf, will return to the same set at the same time. So the level sets consist of some collection of stable leaves. So you vary time, you get one such small rectangle, then you get another one, third one, and you have countably many of them. Because the inducing time goes to infinity. The first return time goes to infinity. They do not cover, those sets do not cover the whole rectangle, because there may be some points which never return. For example, a point on a separate rix may go to zero and never return. Except this one. Is there another point which does not return? That I don't know. The matter is, almost every point is dense, but not every point. And there are some exceptional points which are kind of hard to find. So that I don't know exactly. I believe it's true, but maybe I'm wrong. That I don't know. But whatever it is, it's a set of zero mirror. That's I know for sure, and that's what matters to me. And also, there are some points which lies on the boundary of Markov partitions, which I also consider kind of a bad points. So if I take those which do not return and those which falls in the boundary of Markov partition, I get some set which I call a bad set. And what I claim that this set has zero measure on any stable leaf. Now, what happened next is that if I consider the image of the stable set by the Katok map in the appropriate power, each stable set is associated to return time, then I obtain a set which I call a U set, which just have this form, which is a rectangle which consists of unstable leaves, and it ends exactly on the boundary of the Markov partition. So you have a property that each stable leaf moves into the unstable. Stable strip moves into the unstable strip. This is called a branch. So and those stable leaves are disjoint, and the branch and the unstable leaves are disjoint because it's the first return time. So it's a very nice and simple picture. So then my next step is that I have a conjugacy, which means that I can move this picture by conjugacy here. I got an element which is no longer kind of a real rectangle, it's kind of a curved rectangle, which can still be partitioned by stable strips whose image are unstable strips. They're pretty much the same picture. The return time is the same for the linear map and for the nonlinear map. And in fact, combinatorics of the picture for the linear map is exactly the same as for the nonlinear one. Okay, so that's where I use conjugacy. That's important. Now, the next step, I have troubles with that, okay. The next step is that the new set that I obtain, is what I just mentioned, is built by stable leaves. Now stable leaves for the Katok map, because the conjugacy moves stable leaves for the linear to the stable leaves of the Katok. So the picture is just easy to see. So we move next. So what I do now is that I consider the set lambda, which is the intersection of all stable leaves with all unstable leaves. This is the set that has full area, but it's not the. There are some bad sets of zero area inside. So lambda is kind of a set, which is called a set with hyperbolic product structure. And it has certain properties. And I want to list those properties. The first one is that for every unstable leaf, the intersection of what's left, not covered with this unstable leaf, has zero leaf volume, meaning that it's actually length along the unstable curve. So if we choose any unstable curve over here, this is my gamma u, and measure the length of those points which are covered by this stable leaf, then it has full measure inside the leaf. So that's just by construction. It's easy to prove. The next property is that it's called so if you take the inducing time, Ti, and now it's not Tx, but Ti, because it's the same on each stable strip. So I number those strips, it's countably many strips, I number them by i's, and I have for each strip, I have a number, real number, Ti. It's actually an integer, right? Where they return back, and they all return back at the same time. So if I measure, if I sum the return time and measure of those which return at this time, then the sum is finite. That's a very crucial property, which I comment on a little bit later. The next one is invariance. You take a stable leaf, you apply the map, induced map, the map, the Katok map in the corresponding part. I'm sorry, it should be capital F. Then it lies inside of the stable, so there is a contraction along stable, uniform contraction along stable, and then you apply it here, you get expansion along unstable, and you have the Markov property, and the Markov property follows from the fact that that was an element of the Markov partition. So I started from a Markov partition, Markov property is automatic. Okay, there are two other properties. Now I consider that what is called induced map. This is just the map on the Katok map raised to the corresponding power. So it's a map. So you take a point x. You take a point x. It goes somewhere. So let's look at the trajectory when you start. Well, it travels. It can go this way, then it can enter, then it can go around, can enter again, whatever. Eventually, it comes back. So you just consider the return map. This is what I call capital F. And this map, curled capital F, and this map is uniformly hyperbolic. As a map of the, from this piece of the element of the Markov partition on itself. This map is uniformly hyperbolic. It contracts uniformly along in the stable leaves. It expands uniformly along the unstable curves. And it has bounded, uniform bounded distortion. Now, how do I know that? The map is non-uniformly hyperbolic. So you have a non-uniformly hyperbolic map, and you found a domain such that the return time to that domain is perfectly uniformly hyperbolic. That's a big deal, right? So proving these two properties is what constitutes the whole proof of the theorem for the Katok, my technical part of the proof. Because you have to know exactly how you go through the slowdown domain. You have to obtain some very nice estimates on how trajectory goes through the slow down domain. So in particular, what you should know is you can construct continuous families of stable and unstable cones, invariant cones. Katok, in his original paper, said that if you just take a cone around horizontal and vertical direction of 45 degree angle, then it's invariant. And it's an easy calculation, not sufficient for our purposes. You need to show, on the other hand, if the angle is too small, then it's simply not true. The statement is not true. So there is kind of a threshold, which is less than 45 degree angle, but it's not too small. And the idea is to find this threshold. It's a part of the business, and it's technically challenging question. Then the next one is to obtain a polynomial bound on the rate of contraction and expansion of vectors which go through the slowdown domain. If you have a slowdown domain, and you take, say, horizontal vector, before you do slow down, it will exit perfectly horizontal, would have a nice, the length will expand for the linear map, as usual. But if you slow down it here, so you have many more points to go, then this vector will not return vertical, it will return like this. It will be a little bit bigger, the question is how much bigger. And you have to control all of that. You have to control the angle it will get exit. You have to control how much it will expand versus the time it spends. Because if you go this way, the time you spend is substantially longer. So there will be difference between angle and the length. And you have to control all of that. And if you do, then you can prove these properties by 4 and by 5. That's what it requires. So I'm not going to discuss that because it's a technical issues, but it occupies like 80% of the arguments or whatever. Okay. Now, once this is done, we are close to the proof of the result. Namely, I say that if you have a set lambda with hyperbolic product structure, just think about this Markov rectangle with stable and unstable curves, which satisfies these properties, y1, y5. And again, I just repeat that it means that if you take a stable leaf here, unstable leaf here, that stable sets fill in the full measure. Then you have uniform, the induced map is uniformly hyperbolic. There's Markov property, invariance, et cetera, et cetera. If this all holds, then this diffeomorphism is called Young diffeomorphism. It was introduced, this class of system was introduced by Young in 1998 paper. And what she says that such map has a tower. You can easily build a tower. Now, tower constructions in ergodic theory is well-known old object. But that is special tower. That's why we call it Young tower. What it has a base, which is lambda, and then it has height, which is the induced time. And in our case, the induced time is first return time. So what we built a first return time Young tower for the Katok map. Now, what good does it do for us? Here is the main result. So I consider a diffeomorphism with Young, I consider a Young diffeomorphism, and I consider the geometric potential. That's the class of potentials I'm interested in. I look at the set Sn of those stable sets for which the induced time is n. What I mean by that is the following. Let me draw this picture once again. I told you that when you have this rectangle, you look at the time when it returns, say, time n. You want time x, tau x to be n. And you look at those points which travel, and return back at time n. What you're going to see is the following. You're going to see a strip, as I explained. But you may find another strip, and a third one. So the question is, how many such strips I have at a given time n? Now, the number grows with n. And I want to control how does it grow. And for that, I introduce this number Sn, which tells me how many strips, different strips you have at time n. Then there is another condition which is called the arithmetic condition. You look at the set of all values of tau I. This is a subset among the integers, positive integers, right? You look at the greatest common denominator, and it has to be 1. So then I say the tau satisfies the arithmetic condition. Okay, why not? Here is a theorem. If I have a Young tower, just a Young tower, satisfies properties y1, y5, then there exists an equilibrium measure mu1 for the potential phi1, which is an SRB measure. That's a result by Young. That's what she proved in her 97, and then another paper, 98, she discussed exactly existence of SRB measures. Next is that assume that this number Sn grows exponentially with some constant, with some exponent h, which is less then minus integral of that potential phi 1 with respect to the measure mu 1. This is the Lyapunov exponent of the SRB measure, nothing else but that. Ready? Sn is the number of stable strips which returns back at time n. Then there exists a number t naught such that there exists a measure mu t, unique equilibrium measure for the potential mu t. So you have this picture. Starting from 1 till some t naught, unique equilibrium measure. Okay? But that requires this assumption. And in fact, this measure is Bernoulli. You can prove Bernoulli property. Then, if the arithmetic condition holds, that's why I needed it, the measure mu t has exponential decay of correlations, satisfies central limit theorem for the class of these potentials. So you have a very nice ergodic properties. I'd like to tell you that this statement for SRB measures, again, was proved by Leys and Young. But for equilibrium measures, this is a new result. And the pressure function is real analytic on this interval t naught t. So that's the general result, which was proved by Sam Sainty, Kerr Jenk, and myself. The paper appeared last year. And this is a major result that we will use to prove everything for the Katok map. So what needs to be done is a simple fact. To prove the main result is I need to show this estimate, Sn. I need to show that tau I satisfies arithmetic condition. And I need to show that I can push T naught arbitrarily far. And I need to show that the measure I obtain unique equilibrium measure on the tower. I want to show that that's a unique equilibrium measure among all measures, not just the ones on the tower, because the tower occupies some part of the space, but not necessarily the whole space. So there may be another invariant measure. So maybe they give more, they also may be equilibrium measures. So I claim that, no, this doesn't happen. So that's what needs to be shown. And I very briefly, do I have like 2-3 minutes? Okay, thank you. I mean, I'm almost done at this point. So I just want to comment on how one can prove this exponential bound on the number. And the idea is the following. If you look, the matter is that here is the Katok map. And the inducing time for the Katok map is the same as for the linear map. So if I want to prove anything about the number, I can prove it for the linear map. And for the linear map, I have symbolic dynamics. So what I'm gonna, what I'm looking at is the number, I mean, if I use Markov partitions and I look at the number of words, symbolic words, which starts with P tilde with this element, ends with P tilde, and there is no P tilde in between. So I'm looking, so each such word will give me one element which returns at time n. So how many such elements I have? It's the number of those words. And then there is a well-known result in symbolic dynamics that those numbers grow not faster than topological entropy. So the number of those words, Sn, does not it grow is Ehn with h less than topological entropy of A. But A is a linear map. For the linear map, the topological entropy is the metric entropy of measure 1 for A. Because in this case, the area, the kind of SRB measures, the one that comes here at t equal to 1, this is area, is the same as measure of maximal entropy. So the entropies coincide. So now when I make a perturbation, if the size of the perturbation is small, this one becomes smaller than the topological entropy. So when I put F here and I like look at the H top of F, then it will be bigger than h mu 1 for f. But the difference between them can be made arbitrarily small if the size of perturbation is small. So there is a distance between h and this number, call it epsilon. I can make a perturbation so small, so this distance is epsilon over 2. And therefore, what I would have this h less than this number, and that's verification of the condition. Okay? Then, one more minute. How to verify the arithmetic condition? Well, again, the arithmetic condition is about the height, that the common denominator is 1. But the inducing function for a Katok map and for the linear map are the same, so I can verify it for A. How do I verify it for A? I say that I know that A is Bernoulli, which means that every power is ergodic. And then it's simple argument, you can find it in Leysan Young paper, which claims that if you have this property for A, then the arithmetic condition holds for A, and hence for the Katok map. So that's the verification of the two conditions. And the last piece I want to show is this is a formula that can be obtained by calculation for the number T naught, the one that bounds the interval. And, this is the topological entropy, this is a metric entropy, this is a metric matter, and this is a number log k, which is computed by a specific formula. And then you can show that if the size of the calculation of the slowdown goes to zero, then this difference goes to zero, and therefore T naught goes to minus infinity, and that's it. Thank you very much.